Hello everyone, nice to meet you for the new webinar for the Africa Esports Series educational program. My name is Boris Bergerot. I'm the founder of Stacken Group. I'm based in the south of France, in the city of Montpellier. And tonight we will speak about who and why we can raise funds in esports. So I hope everybody is in a safe way, of course, and I just want to share my screen in order to present the different activities for the session of tonight. So I'd like to present shortly the summary of the webinar. The first part will be dedicated to esports dedicated VC funds. So we will see exactly how works, of course, the process about fundraising. What is the main goals to fund raise, who can fund raise, of course, because we have many sectors that could be interested about raising fund. A quick overview of the investment opportunity, and of course, to achieve the presentation, we will speak about the last esports team that have been fundraised. And we will speak as well about the main stakeholders in the industry and their involvement in esports and how they invest in esports. So, first of all, I'd like to remind you that esports is the competitive way to practice video games. You can practice online, you can practice on LAN parties. And esports is at the crossroads of the video games industry, the entertainment side, and technologies and sports. It means that you have many opportunities to invest in specific sectors. It could be about technologies, it could be about fan experience, it could be about the publishers, the event organizers, and many topics. So we will see exactly how it works. So this is quickly the summary that we will speak about tonight. So I'd like to, of course, introduce myself because I think it's interesting to see how the business in esports is moving years after years. And I'd like to explain a little bit what we are doing at Stacken Group. So we have an agency called Stacken Agency with a specific focus on three main activities. The first one is doing strategic consulting for non-anemic brands, sports club, investors, and the goal is to help them understand the issues, the stakes, the ecosystem, and how to be involved in esports. So we concretely are making some strategic recommendation with the operational side, and we support our clients to imagine and to set up the best possible strategy in esports. So it could be about investing in esports, it could be about organizing an event, it could be about sponsorship for a team, it could be about sponsoring an event, or many topics. We also have a dedicated unit, business unit for all topics related to talent representation. So we have the chance to have some of the best pro gamers in the world, specifically in sim racing, but also in other esports sectors. So with them to be more professional, we support them about legal aspect, we support them about community management, about mental coaching, about many things. We also have some sports, traditional sports athletes, and that's the same with them in different manners. It could be, for example, doing some marketing activation, seeking some new sponsors, organizing some show matches with other people, supporting them about the community management, for example. And the third topic of a Stacking Agency is focused on organization. So we organize business events, focus, of course, on esports, because that's the core business we have at the company. So we support some cities, some metropoles, some traditional event organizers to organize a business day, for example, or to organize some conferences, or organize some specific keynotes, workshop, and many topics to democratize esports and to allow people to meet different personalities, celebrities in the esports or in the non-Olympic ecosystem. So mainly esports agency, Stacking Agency, our esports agency, sorry, is the doing consulting, organizes some events, business events, and represents some of the best talents in esports and in sports. We also have another subsidiary called Stacking Innovation. And the goal of Stacking Innovation is to imagine what could be the next generation of esports and entertainment facilities. So we support some property developers, some investors, some city to imagine, to organize a specific venue and to create the venue with the architect and with the promoters, etc., to imagine some specific location to aggregate people. It could be about business, it could be about schools, it could be about virtual reality center, augmented reality center, escape games, restaurant, co-working, co-living, and many things. So we are working with a dozen of clients around the world, and we help them to imagine the concept, to define the business models of the venue, and also we source all the potential promoters to involve them in the location. And so mainly Stacking Innovation is focused on creating specific location around the world in different cities to unify the ecosystem of esports and entertainment. The last subsidiary we have, and that we will launch in a few, in a couple of weeks, sorry, it's Stacking Invest, and is very close to what we are. We will speak tonight is about fundraising. So the goal of the agency of Stacking Invest is to support the startups to raise funds and to find their investors, their business angel, their VC fund, their next partner to grow up in the ecosystem and to raise from 100 key euros to 5 million euros. So with them about all the materials, about the pitch deck, about the business plan, about the some marketing stuff, about many topics. And the goal is that for them is to be ready to speak with some investors, and for the investors is to find the best startups to invest in. So this is a global overview of Stacking Group. So Stacking Agency, Stacking Invest, Stacking Innovation. So we cover a wide sectors of esports. Of course, we are not doing everything in esports. Of course, we have many partners around the world. Of course, we don't organize events like specific event organizers like ESL or some different companies, but we are very expert in the three topics, consulting, innovation, and financial aspects. Let me just speak about the ecosystem, the esports market and the esports ecosystem to understand how it works and to help you understand what could be the best sectors to invest and of course to understand the global ecosystem of the electronic sports. So you have on the screen you have the publishers that are controlling many things in esports. They develop their video game. So I'm sure you know FIFA, Overwatch, League of Legends, Counter-Strike, Valorant, and Fortnite, and many other titles. So the publishers develop and promote their own video games. So you know probably the name of the publishers like Electronic Arts, Ubisoft, Blizzard, Activision. You have Riot Games, Valve, and many other. And the thing is that the biggest publisher is called Tencent, a Chinese company that owns Riot Games, Supercell, that has some shares in Epic Games, the publisher of Fortnite and Rocket League, and now Fall Guys as well. And you have big companies around the world, in North America, in Asia, also in Europe, like Ubisoft, and they try to sell their video games on the different platforms. It could be on PC, on console, on smartphone, for example. And the esports ecosystem is the top of the strategy for them, because it's a good way to promote and to reach new clients and to develop their brand awareness thanks to the esports ecosystem, the esports tournaments online or offline. So you have the publishers. Of course, without teams, you can't play a video game in the competitive side. So many teams around the world are competing, are fighting against each other to be the best in their league or in their tournament. So you know probably Cloud9, TSM, Fnatic, Team Liquid, Rogue, SKT, T1, or many Astralis, Fnatic, and many other professional esports teams. So they are playing most of the time on different titles. So you have sometimes 3, 4, 5, or 10 or more video game titles that they are involved in. So, for example, Vitality is playing on the League of Legends Championship on League of Legends, but they are also competing in Rocket League, in FIFA, and in different and CS:GO and different video games. So, the professional teams pay their pro gamers. So the pro gamers receive some salaries from the teams, and they can receive salaries because the team could probably have some funds coming from investors or some funds coming from some of the channels like merchandising, like a little bit media right, but most the main channel about the incomes, about the revenue for a professional team is the sponsorship. So most of the time it's between 40 and 60% of the global budget of a team with the sponsors. You have, of course, events. So events online or offline, of course, it depends on the sanitary situation, but I'm sure you know some big events like the IEM in Katowice from ESL, or some big events in North America. You have some leagues as well, the Overwatch League, the League of Legends league, could be continental or national. You have some mobile league, you have some versus fighting league as well, many sim racing league. So the sim racing is the video games focus on racing and simulation. So maybe you know iRacing, Air Factor, Project Cars, Gran Turismo, Forza Motorsport. So you of course have as well some league like the Formula One E-Series, for example. You have the publishers, you have the teams, you have some specific events, one-shot events or events included in a big championship, for example, and you have some leagues. open or closed league. Of course, you have different stakeholders around these four pillars that are the publishers, the team, the event, and the events and the leagues. You have all the consumers, online or offline, all the sponsors that are, that could be, for example, some brands, endemic brands or non-endemic brands. You have all the technological aspects of the esports about virtual reality, augmented reality, big data, etc. So we will speak in the next webinar about the trends and the innovation in esports. So we will focus on virtual reality, extended reality, big data, artificial intelligence, etc. So it's very interesting to see how it can help the development of esports, and it's also a specific sector that investors are looking for to invest and to support about the startups in different countries. And you have all the agencies, all the startups that are developing some online platform, gaming platform, tournament platform, matchmaking platform, fan experience, and blockchain, and many other topics that, of course, are included in the ecosystem and that concretely interest some investors. So, just a quick preamble about the financial topics around esports is about the process for a company to raise fund. So, you have a short design about the four steps, the main steps to raise funds. The first one is to organize all the materials, is to create a kind of audit and benchmark of the company, of the startups, to understand if all the key elements are okay. And of course, the two documents very important for investors are the pitch deck. So it's a kind of a summary of all the important information about the team, about the strategy, about the key metrics you have, about the forecast you have about financial aspects, about the business model. So it's a kind of a short document to explain to investors exactly who you are, what are your business, what are your business model, what are your market, what are your audience, what are the personas to target or to reach out with your product or your service. And the business plan is a more detailed document with all the financial elements, the different items useful to help investors to understand exactly what, if you have any traction, if you have any incomes, what do you plan for the year, for the next year, for the 3, 4, 5 coming years, and to make them understand if they have some opportunities, some interest to invest in your company. When you speak about the roadshow is about for investors a kind of startup targeting. It means that the goal is to identify what could be the best startup or the best investor for the moment, to define the different values, and of course to imagine and to understand the KPIs, so the key performance indicators useful about the raise they want to make. Then when you have a matching between investors, so you have a kind of negotiation that will start between the investors and a startup or a company. So the goal is to support like a company like mine, until the negotiation between the two parts. So the goal is to, so you have a due diligence, and the due diligence allows people to understand exactly how they can work with each other and how they can imagine the best investment process. And then you have the, after the negotiation, you have the closing part. So the phase about the closing, the goal is, of course, to succeed and to have some new investors in the company. So you contract with the investors, and you have money on your bank account, and you start your strategy thanks to the strategy you define in your business plan, with, of course, a share, some new shares for the investors. So you give a part of your company to the investors. So it could be business angel, VC, or different typologies of investors, private or sometimes public, and they own finally some shares in your company. And the goal for them is to have a strong ROI, so a return on investment, when we speak about the exit. So the exit is when a company is sold to another one, and the investors will have again their funds, but with a coefficient, with a multiplication of sometimes 3, 4, 5, 10, or I don't know, at the end. So, of course, like for just an example, if you bought some bitcoins some years ago, now you have a strong coefficient about the money you will earn because of the inflation, because of the development of the bitcoin. So the goal for investors is to multiplicate their investment at the end. And most of the time, it's between 5 and 7 years that they want to exit from your company. But you have to understand that about startups, what is very interesting is not only speaking about the money you will have thanks to investors, is also to have, yes, of course, money to develop your strategy, to hire some new people, to pay the salaries, to pay the marketing stuff, to develop your business in a new country, in a new market, or I don't know. But it's also to have the opportunity to work with new people, some kind of advisors coming from the VC fund or the business angels involved. So most of the time, you have different business angels, different VCs that are investing in some startups, and they add to the startups some knowledges, some networks that could be relevant to boost the strategy of the startup. So it's not about financial side, it's also to develop the network, to have some support from new people coming from some banks, some investing funds, some equity funds, some business angels, and they are interested as well to support you, because it's of course on their interest to support your strategy, because they invest and they want to multiplicate the investment at the end. So they are involved in your company. They give you some advices. They make some go-between with some key people to develop new partnership, to develop your business in some new countries, new continents. And of course, the goal is to increase your incomes. So this is the four phases about the process to raise funds. You can raise funds. This is a short graphic about the growth cycle and about the company financing, because when you start creating your company, your startup, you define, you have a project, you have some specific ideas about technologies, about human resource, about the targets you have, and you need to sometimes spend some money in research and development, for example. So the classical growth cycle of a company, so you have different curves in the graphics. In yellow is about the profitability, and you have in black the funding, and between the funding requirements. So it means from the beginning, when you have an idea, until the expansion and the development, of course, you will lose most of the time some money because you invest in research and development. You have to create, you have to make your first steps to develop your company. So if you have the chance to have your own money, we most of the time we speak of love money. So you can have some, nice package to start and to invest about technical aspect, about hiring people. But if you want to go faster in your cycle, in your process about the development of your strategy, you need to raise funds to finance the development of the project, to acquire your first client, to invest in marketing, in communication, and some months or some years after, to start the expansion course and to develop your business. So you have different cycles about fundraising. So this is the relationship between the cycle and the financial opportunities. So we speak about pre-seed when it's just the beginning of your company. So you can have most of the time we speak about love money. So it's your family, it's your friend that supports you with some money to create a strong package to start something. But you also have some specific company that are investing from the beginning of your company, not necessarily when you are developing in different countries or whatever. So of course we speak about risk, we speak about specific companies in the finance that are able to invest money and also to take a risk and also to lose some money, because we used to hear sometimes that investors invest in 10 companies and they only made profit with just one company. So they lose money with the 9 others. So it's very important to have some investors able to support the young companies from the beginning. So most of the time you have a capital investment and private equity. You have sometimes business angel, but you have also what we call the contribution or the subsidies, some support from specific government bodies, or some, for example, some support from the city where you are developing your business. Then you have the next phase is called the seed, and then the pre-seria, the serie, and the serie B, the serie C, etc. You can make a round table, the first round table, for example, about 100 euros to develop what you called a MVP, or a POC, a proof of concept. So the goal is to show to your client that you have something ready. So you need most of the time to develop with specific technologies, or you have to improve your services or your product. And the first roundtable is used to develop the proof of concept. And after, you can start making some traction, so having some money from the new clients, you can hire new people, and then some months or some years after, you make a second roundtable. For example, in pre-Serie A, if you want to fundraise something like, let's say, for example, 1 million euros or 500,000 euros, you can after make a third roundtable of 5 million, etc., etc. So it's not about when you start looking, seeking some investors. It depends, of course, on your strategy, on your business, on your market and audiences, and the stages about the development when you want to boost, your growth. From pre-seed to Series C, for example, you can reach out some venture capital, you can have some business angels, some family office, some seed funds, some private equity. So it depends on the stage, it depends on the strategy, it depends, of course, on the amount you want to fundraise. Because if you want to fundraise 100 euros, it's not about the VC, you will find 100 euros, but probably with 4 or 5, for example, business angels that will support you and that will invest in your company. So, about esports, the topic that will interest you tonight, about esports, you have to understand that we don't have many dedicated esports funds around the world. Of course we have, but it's not the same as, for example, in the food industry, in the tech industry, in the green industry, in the health industry, when you have some dozen or hundred funds dedicated to a specific sector. So, as esports is at the crossroad of sports, entertainment, video games, and technologies, you have some investors with specific interest of one of the sectors just mentioned before, but they are watching what's happening in the esports industry. And of course, you know that thanks to the COVID and the different lockdowns, the ecosystem and the visibility of esports is something very interesting for new investors, and because of the audience, the viewership on the platform streaming, about the sponsorship and many things. So it moves very quickly, and many funds are nowadays interesting in the way to invest in the esports ecosystem. So it's typically the goal of my company with Stakion Invest that we will launch in a couple of weeks is to support the investors to understand exactly how it works, what is the best startup to invest thanks to their requirements, because they want sometimes to invest 1 million or just some few key euros or 100 key euros, or they have a portfolio of big companies and they want to invest something like 10 million in different companies in esports, but they don't know exactly the different sectors in esports. So we will speak just after about the sector to invest, and they don't know how it works. They don't know the kind of ROI they can expect. So the goal is to educate them and support them in finding the best esports companies to invest in. So it's the right time to invest because of the growth of audience, because you have new business models, because it's not so hard to invest in esports compare to some specific sectors like music, sports, technologies, where the amounts are very big and you have a strong competition. So it's the right time for investors to be the first in a specific industry like esports or inside esports, about event organizers, about platform services on different sectors in the industry. So as it's a fast growing market, it could interest then about ROI. But of course, it's too early for the moment to be sure that if you invest in esports, you be totally sure to make a strong benefit at the end, because you know, the COVID is not so easy to interpret, to understand, because you have a strong competition is in specific sectors like the publishers, for example, or the event organizers or the tournament platform. So it's not so easy to you have to take risk as an investor to raise, to support, to invest in different startups or companies in esports. So the generalist, the funds, the traditional funds interested in investing, for example, in traditional sports or in technologies like artificial intelligence, big data, data analytics, and many other things, want to diversify their investment, and they want to understand how it works in esports, and sometimes they invest in specific companies. But on the other end, you have dedicated esports funds, like the two you have on the screen, the Bitcraft.net and the Trust Esports. So Bitcraft is a company based in Germany, founded by Jens Ingers, one of the former co-founder of ESL, the Electronic Sport League. So Jens Ingers is heading Bitcraft for many years. He has developed a fund with 155 million dollars to a kind of yes, it's the amount of the fund available to invest in specific companies. So they invest in some companies like PandaScore, the StoryMob, and I think sometimes like something like 20 or more companies. It could be about services, it could be about mobile app, or in different companies. They are interested and they invested in such companies in most of the time in Europe, for example. So Bitcraft is probably, I think, the biggest esports dedicated VC fund we have, and of course some in some countries you see some other funds that are coming in the market. You also have in France a VC fund called Trust Esports, running by Mathieu Dallon. Mathieu Dallon is one of the best and well-known people in the French market, as is involved for more than 20 years in the esports ecosystem in France, and he was the owner of OSWC, an event organizer, but also a web platform, a tournament platform called tournament.com, and many other things. And he sold his companies to Webedia, a giant in France in entertainment, and is now heading Trust Esports to invest in some specific startups in about fan experience, about audience monetization, and different topic. So for the moment, they invest in, I guess, five or six six companies, and sometimes they are as well invest with Bitcraft in the same company. So this is some few but specific VC funds focusing on esports market. And probably, I think we will have in the coming years more and more specific VC funds focused on electronic sports, but probably electronic sports and entertainment, or electronic sports and immersive technologies, or electronic funds, electronic sports, sorry, and traditional sports, but with the core business focus on esports. The question is, if you are an investor, who is the your target, and why invest in esports? So this is a quick overview, but a non-exhaustive overview of some sectors you can invest if you are an investor, a BC, a VC funds, a private equity company, a family office, etc. So of course, the esports organization, the professional esports organization, are probably the main topic about investment. For example, in France, you have a company called Rewired that invested 34 million euros in the esports organization called Vitality. I guess 14 million euros, and then 20, then 14. I don't remember, but you have $34 million or euros invested by a company to support the growth and the strategy of the team Vitality in France. So the goal is to hire new people, is to pay the best salaries for the best player, is to develop their business in India, for example, and to develop the growth of the company. You can invest, of course, in the media, so on web TV, on for example, a streaming platform, or yes, on the web, on online environment, on some specific startups, startups developing new equipment for the pro gamers or for the audience. You can invest, of course, about the venues, about the gaming center, the gaming house, if you want to have your own location, or if you want to have a strong strategy about with the property developers. You can invest about in training, or you can create a school, or just support people creating a school in esports and to invest in such companies. You can invest about online and offline experience. So the fan experience and the user experiences are very interesting because of the opportunity for the people to have a new interaction between their teams, their pro gamers that are following, and it could be online, it could be offline. So you have as well many startups around the online or offline experiences with virtual reality, augmented reality, etc. So you also have investment in event organizers, in platform, and many different topics. So this is for some examples of brands that have been baked by some investors. So you have here some companies like PandaScore, for example, that have been baked by Bitcraft. So we speak about developer tools, we speak about the publishers, for example. So you have investment from Tencent, from different people on the bank and VC fund in Epic Games to support the development of Fortnite and the different titles and the store of Epic Games and etc. So sometimes you have many people. If you organize, for example, an IPO is the way to move in the public ecosystem and to have, if possible, many people Everybody investing, not necessary funds, specific funds. It's the case, for example, of Astralis. They made an IPO to go to the public market. Here you are the developers and the publishers, you have the distribution platform. Maybe you know, for example, just an example of Blade. Blade is a company producing an equipment called Shadow, and it's about cloud gaming. So you can play without your own PC. You just pay a fee every month to have a specific equipment on your office, and all the technical side of the computer is virtualized in some data centers. So you don't need any chipset, you don't have any graphics materials, etc. So Blade is producing the hardware, the software, all the protocols to allow people playing without any PC or a specific gaming computer at home, just thanks to the technologies. So they received some investment from different banks and VC fund. So we speak about distribution platform or technologies to display some information or to develop some specific protocol. You have access points. So about a console, about PC, about the smartphone. You have, of course, all the esports talent and sponsors that could be a good way to make some investment. So people are investing. It could be celebrities. It could be VC, private equity funds to interested in specific teams like Cloud9, like Vitality, like Immortals. Team Liquid and many others. So it's a way of investing in esports. As we said just previously, it's about the esports teams. You have the different platforms. You have all the broadcasting aspects. You have all the streaming aspects. Maybe you know Twitch. So Twitch has been acquired by Amazon 5 years ago with an amount close to $1 billion. So I think it was in 2016, and it was $960 million dollars. You have doyou.com, you have yua.com, and Discord, of course. Maybe you know Discord. Discord is a good way to practice, to speak, to chat with many people, and to support when you practice video games. So it's a kind of a very big platform to interact with many people and to speak and to make your strategy or to upload some files and to collaborate online. So this is some example about some sectors you can fund if you are, for example, an investor. So a quick overview of the esports investment by investor types. So you see that the venture capital is more than 50% of the type of companies investing in esports. You have the family office, you have the private equity, you have the strategic investors. Of course, you have some business angels, you have some celebrities coming from the sports. So you have people in basket in basketball, for example, like Shaquille O'Neal, like Rudy Gobert, like many other people, Michael Jordan investing in some companies as a celebrity. But most of the time, the venture capital is the type of investor the most implicated in esports. This is an overview of the some investment that the ecosystem received in the last months. So this is some screenshot coming from the esportsobserver.com website. You have we were talking about Bitcraft. Bitcraft has invested $2.5 million in Bazooka Tango in a seed phase. You have Unicorns of Love that have a secure strategic investment to open an esports space in the city of Hamburg. You have FaZe Clan that have made a strategy to boost the development of the company, and with a $40 million Serie A investment from different people and VC fund, etc. So you can here you have a quick overview of the way to invest in esports about esports organization like, for example, FaZe Clan or, for example, Tribe Gaming or Unicorns or Guild Esports. You have some investments about apparel, esports apparel. So the brand Raven, for example, secured $1.4 million seed investment to develop their strategy about creating some clothes for the esports ecosystem. So it's an apparel brand that has made some fundraising. It was something like 1 year ago. You have also some funds for location esports arena. That's the case for Veritas with a specific dedicated arena and the goal of investing in arena or fundraising money to create an arena or gaming center is to develop their business inside the venue with merchandising, with conferences, with show matches, etc., etc. So different topics and a quick investment overview in esports about esports team, about arenas, about brand apparel and many things. So every day you have, if you watch websites like esportsobserver.com, esportsinsider.com, evenglobal.com and many other websites you have around the world. You will see new sponsorship, new investment, new strategy for the different sectors we were speaking just before. Then this is about the overview of some the market capitalization of big brands in esports, and you have the country, you have the name, so the valuation of Activision Blizzard, for example, is we speak about billions of dollars. You have Electronic Arts, you have Yuwa in China. But if you look in the last column on the right, you have the brands represented by the company. So about Blizzard, you have Overwatch, Call of Duty, World of Warcraft. About Electronic Arts, you have FIFA, Madden, Apex Legends. About Yua, which is a media platform, you have Royal Never Give Up. You have Chengdu Hunters. So they as well invest in some esports team, etc. So if you are seeing these figures, the last one of the dashboard is Tencent. Tencent, as I said in the ecosystem overview in the first slide I presented, is the biggest giant in the world about video games, about esports, because they own many things. They have their own studios. They acquired many companies. They own Riot Games with League of Legends. They own a big part in Epic Games. They own Supercell with Clash Royale, Clash of Clans. And yes, they made investment as a big company. They made investment or they acquire some companies in esports and video games, probably dozens and dozens. Finally, I'd like to speak about some last teams in esports that have been fundraised. So it moves every day, and the goal of the investment about fundraising for esports team is not exactly the same depending on the location, depending on the, of course, the goals of the founders about much developing the merchandising, developing some the strategy with new titles, and opening competitive teams, for example, in a new title like Valorant, like CSGO, or other. Sometimes the goal is to develop a strategy in a new market. Sometimes is to pay the salaries of the best pro gamers. So all the esports team don't have exactly the same strategy when they want to raise funds in esports. But for example, Fnatic, I guess you know the team Fnatic, secured some months ago a 10 million investment, and also made a crowdfunding subscription. So they open for everybody the opportunity to have some shares in their company, but they wanted to involve all their community and to give them some reward if they want to support them about the crowdfunding system. So they fundraised, and they also made a crowdfunding campaign. Tribe Gaming. Tribe is focused on mobile, so it's a mobile-centric esports organization which has closed a seed funding round of $1 million. Sorry, it was something 1 year ago, and a guy from NBA playing in the Boston Celtics, and the name is Gordon Hayward, and as well another big celebrity, Claudio Cesaro Castelloni, from the WWE. They invested and stay as invest as advisors in the company, and the goal is to open the doors and to help them Tribe Gaming to develop their business thanks to the urge network of the two celebrities, and of course with the investment they received. We have the team Simplicity, for example, that has received 500 key euros from a fund called Triton Funds. Simplicity Sports is a North American organization which owns and manages different esports teams. And the most notably is called Flamengo Esports in Brazil, and playing in the Premier League of the League of Legends competition in Brazil. You have Unicorns on Love that has received investment from an investor called Tomislav Karadzica, and the Berlin organization Unicorns of Love has the project to develop many topics in Austria and in different cities, and to partner with some specific sports club, for example. The last one I want to show tonight is you have investment around the world, and of course as well in MENA, for example, in Middle East and North Africa. You have the Egyptian esports team Anubis that closed 300, sorry, key euros or dollars in seed. So it's not a very Anubis is not a tier one or a top professional organization in the world, but they are moving very fast, and they need some money to develop their strategy and to attract new sponsors and to pay salaries, etc. So it was a small amount of investment they received, but it's a first roundtable, an interesting first roundtable to go further. Maybe you heard about Guild Esports with David Beckham as an advisor, but also as an investor. Beck invested close to $20 million in the Guild Esports company. The goal is to create a brand awareness. If you have many celebrities or big investors for your first or second roundtables, it's a good way to secure the next roundtables that we will do because of the credibility of the advisors, the credibility of the celebrities. But of course, you have to show the metrics, and if you have no traction, if you have no clients, if you have no concrete and real business, you won't be able to go to the next step and to raise new funds. So this is mainly what I wanted to say tonight about the investment size and what are the opportunities for the investors, but also how works the investment process for the startup, for the company. You probably understand that you have many areas that could be focused about the investors, like investment in publishers, in esports team, in venues, in agencies. It could be about services, it could be about equipment, about apparel, about many topics. And the goal, of course, is to, for the company looking for new funds, and is to have all the materials to show to investors, to go to negotiate, to go to the closing, and then to sell some shares of their company. But they receive some money. They receive some advices. They receive the opportunity to boost their business thanks of the network of the VC funds, the business angel, the celebrity that have been some new shareholders of the company. And esports is attracting more and more people around the world because of the not only about the keywords, not about the buzz, but about the concrete opportunity for investors to start investing a little bit of money and to bet that in the future it will be very interesting about the benefits. So many CEO of co-founders or founders of esports team said that if you invest in an esports organization now, it's interesting, but you will lose some money. You have to expect that the valuation and the market and the stability of the business models of the esports ecosystem will allow the investors in probably 7 or 10 years to make some profits. So you have some risk for the investors, but it's also an opportunity to to invest in the best promising companies, startups, company like Blade, for example, who made something like 4, 3, or 4 different roundtables. So it's a way to finance the development. Of course, you also have to understand that it's not totally necessary to raise funds if you want to develop your business. It's the strategy you have as a founder of a co-founder of a company, and you decide, you choose to raise funds because of your global strategy, because of your needs about human resource, about technological issues you have, for example. But it's not obligatory to develop your business with investors. It's a good way sometimes, but sometimes it's not the best way to go to the right direction. But the goal of my company, like the subsidiary we have called Stack and Invest, is to support the startups and the companies to reach out the best investors, VC, private equity, family office, bank, and to make the best matchmaking about the global strategy, of course, money, but as well about the vision of the investors they have, the network of the investors, and the opportunity for both to grow up together. So thanks for your time. I hope this new webinar about raising funds was a little bit interesting to understand some specific topics. And if you have some question, let me know on the chat on YouTube, but also you can reach out on LinkedIn. My name is Boris Bergerot. I'll be happy to chat with you, to speak about your project, about and respond to your different questions. So I hope it was interesting, and I see you soon for the last conference. I will show about the trends and innovation in esports. Bye bye.